Hello and welcome to ESG, A Bridge to Action. This is a show presented by PricewaterhouseCoopers in association with moneycontrol.com. Today we are going to talk about circular economy. Let me welcome on the show two gentlemen who are going to throw more light on this. Mohit Malhotra, who is the CEO at Dabur India, and Shivanshu Chauhan from PwC India. Gentlemen, so good to have you on the show. But before the discussion, let's hear out a special message on sustainability.
Any manufacturing company today, when they are working, they have to first see that they are energy-wise efficient and also sustainable environmentally. I can give you example of in dairy, right from milk production to the plant level, what are the environmental friendly or sustainable practices we are taking. I mean, now what we are working is right from dung, what we farmers are producing, how to create biogas out of it. And whatever slurry is left, how to make biofertilizer to go for organic agriculture. Similarly, in dairy plants, you see a lot of water and the effluent is there. So each and every liter of effluent is treated. Biogas is produced, gas is condensed, and then it is being used in the dairy plant for various production processes. What I can tell you is in manufacturing process, you can go for n number of energy consumption thing. But today, the one thing which is going to work is how much sustainable your manufacturing process is environmentally. Because today, everybody is going to measure that for each liter of milk or each one unit of production of your any product which you are manufacturing, how much gases you are producing, how much effluent you are producing, how you are treating the environment. So I think that is going to be the major measurement for efficiency of manufacturing practices in the years to come.
My first question to you, Shivanshu, you are an expert in this particular field. What does the circular economy mean and does it fit into the ESG dynamics of the companies?
Sure. Circular economy is basically a shift from the linear economy in which we have been operating. An economy wherein the resources are mined, the products are consumed, the non-perishable ones and the packaging, etc. is thrown out and it kind of creates more of waste. Now, this is not sustainable because, you know, our resources are finite, the population is growing, and so are the necessities. This is where this shift is happening towards the circular economy. Now, what circular economy does is it operates in a continuous cycle where waste is minimized and value creation is maximized. This is something which will lead to reduced extraction, more reuse, more refurbishing, more recycling, and accordingly reduction in the overall waste that we generate. The criticality has always been appreciated. It is just that it has now elevated to a policy and regulatory level. The conversations have become mainstream. Let me also acknowledge that circular economy is not really new. The corporates have always been practicing it because it makes more business sense and better business sense to maximize value from all projects, all processes, and all products, and all kind of materials that the corporate generate. The whole journey and whole drive towards improving the performance on ESG is kind of leading to more of these conversations and better focus and more focus on the circular economy side. You know, our resources are also finite. We are seeing a lot of these climate change related aspects on which rightfully a lot of debate is happening, be it from adaptation side or the mitigation side. We are also seeing this demographic shift which is happening, which is leading to more and more pressure on our resources and hence leads to more circularity. And all of this, if you look at it, has been facilitated by this whole technological breakthrough which has happened.
Mohit, talk about Dabur India under your leadership. How is circular economy as a concept incorporated and now practiced? And is it part of your ESG initiative or is it a differentiated project that you have taken up?
So Dabur is actually committed to waste management, recycling, and circular economy strategies enable us to recover and do a productive reuse of our waste streams. The organization leads the sustainability and the circular economy initiatives. The vision statement of the company is to dedicate ourselves to health and well-being of every household and the communities and the people that we touch. So it's pretty integral in the sense that the way we guys operate. So we don't merely comply with the regulations as far as ESG is concerned, but responsibly take care of our planet to preserve its beauty and the resources for the future generations. Responsible management of natural resources in our operations has always been a part since the business has been created in inception in 1884. They used to say in Sanskrit, in Rig Veda, Dahi me dadami te. This is a very ancient proverb mentioned in Rig Veda, which in English actually means as much you give to the community or to the ecosystem will give it back to you. That is the guiding principle for the enterprise. I'll maybe give you some illustrative examples of what we guys do. First, let me take on the plastic waste management example of the initiative that we do in Dabur. So this year, we want to become a plastic waste neutral organization. I think we will be the first company to have achieved the plastic waste neutrality. Every year, we generate roughly around 22,000 metric tons of plastic. We consume, we make the products, and we give it out to the consumers. And this year, we'll be recycling, collecting, processing, and recycling the entire 22,000 metric tons by end of the fiscal year. We should be able to achieve our target to become plastic waste neutral company. So right. In that we handle roughly around 15,000 rack pickers. We reach out to 10,000 waste management agencies. We started off as a pilot project, and now it's actually in 27 cities that we are doing plastic waste management. And when we reprocess the plastic, the byproducts like t-shirts, tables, tiles, which are all recycled, we buy it back and we give it to our communities, and people very happily actually use it.
You beautifully also summarized the basic ethos of sustainability. One question for the companies who want to really embark on this journey. I want to understand, you said that you have piloted some projects. So is that the right approach? Or for implementation, you say that a central leadership at the organization level should take care of this transition. How well to execute this from your learnings?
See, we believe that involvement and participation of communities as partners in such initiatives is the one that ensures a sustained success. I'll again give you an example. In plastic waste management, we run a program called 10 kg plastic. As per CPCB, we find that every consumer uses and wastes 10 kg of plastic every year. So what we guys do, that we are running this program in which we've given a helpline number, we've got a little microsite, and we ask the consumers to go onto the microsite and the helpline and tell us. We send vans, the plastic is collected from the vans, it is sent to a central hub from where the plastic is collected and sent to the processing plants from there. So we involve all our communities. We are the first company to have done a toothpaste which is carton free. We save 130 tons of paper that we save. This paper is actually repurposed, and we work with Cry, and which is repurposing that paper to make notebooks which is serving the underserved children. So to your question, I think to run pilot projects is always better, because we iron out any loopholes or any glitches that we face when we run a program. In the plastic waste management, we started with 2 states. Now it is almost 27 states. In herb cultivation program also, we selected few geographies. Now it's been extended to almost 12 states for us. And we do a proof of concept, gets established when you do a pilot, and then you actually roll it out. So this has not been a very smooth journey on ESG for us. So there were a lot of learnings, a lot of pitfalls along the way that we encountered. But as we work with the stakeholders and people like PwC or who are also experts, they also tell us how to navigate those pitfalls and then do it in a more sustained manner as we guys go forward.
Shivanshu, here again, it has to be a commitment made by the company in terms of the cost management as well, for it to be efficient for the company. How does the company really embed these costs and take forward this transition?
I think the need for being environmentally responsible and undertaking sustainable operations is not now seen from the lens of cost. Meaning, I think it is being seen from the lens of value. And that value is both financial and non-financial. So while there will be a startup cost, we also need to look at or take a holistic view on the cost itself, because it has social cost, It has environment cost. It also has cost for the future. So when we shift that lens from cost to value, we see that circularity actually creates more value for the farms and makes them more resilient. And from the value perspective also, we are seeing a big shift, which is corporates also shifting from only looking at the shareholder value to looking at the whole stakeholder value. To kind of achieve all of this and enhance value for all the stakeholders, corporates are actually embedding circularity on all aspects of their business. This is done by, you know, by prioritizing renewable inputs, maximizing the product's use, recovering byproducts and waste, and even adopting regenerative practices. It's a very welcome change to see that the corporates are not just doing business, but are doing better and more sustainable and more responsible businesses. So I think, yes, there may be some cost, but when it has to look at long term from a corporate perspective, and relatively when you look at it, it's a much, much higher value as compared to the startup cost that someone may have to incur.
Now, Mohit, so there are many external factors which would infuse the corporates to enable them to go on this journey. How do you really describe those particular enablers, and what has been your experience on that?
Yeah, so I think that's a good question, because consumer behavior is very critical, and it's just not consumer behavior. I think the term consumer can be broadened to the communities and the environment and the people. And as Dabur as an organization, we serve the rural consumer and we serve the urban consumer. So consumer behavior becomes extremely critical. And this is a change driver going forward for us. I'm already seeing a lot of change happening in urban India, and urban India change is actually driven by today's millennial and the centennial generation, and the generation is rewarding the corporates which are championing the cause of ESG. So if I'm giving a product which is a shampoo, for example, a paraben-free, a chemical-free, a no-nasty or a cruelty-free kind of a shampoo, so the millennials come forward and they are the ones who are rewarding the companies by buying the products and increasing our profit pool. But the percentage of these millennials and the centennials is very small. So the real dichotomy lies in the bottom of the pyramid, which is the rural consumer. Because India is a low per capita market, the consumers are not willing to pay that extra price for the green products that the companies are doing by investing money. And therefore, it doesn't become very a ROI accretive thing. But gradually and slowly, I think the consciousness is setting in. Urban sentiment is flowing into rural. Rural is becoming more urban. And I think things will only get better. It's a journey, like you guys are saying. I'll give you one example of rural India. We are around 12 factories in the country. In every factory, we use groundwater. So when we extract the water from the ground, we, as a responsible citizens and corporates, we have to recharge that water. And we've done this operation in Rajasthan along with our communities in Nivai, in Rajasthan, where on account of this initiative, we've made a pond which collects around 15 lakh liters of water, and the water table has come up now 10 feet. It is not ROI accretive for us to manage that pond. So what we've done is we've given the responsibility to manage that pond to the communities. So communities are now managing that pond very well. And this operation has been running for past, I think, 5-6 years. And now we are trying to do it in the vicinity of every factory, every 12 factories that we guys have got in India. So communities are managing it. This is improving their income, because in Rajasthan, at least the water is available for irrigation in all 12 months, which earlier it wasn't available. And people get water, and therefore it is improving the the soil yield, the crop yield, and therefore also improving the income and also giving occupation to the people. So that's how at least a rural consumer is helping us, and the behavior is changing.
You touched upon a very important point, that is, it has to be ROI accretive as well when it comes to circular economy, and the consumer acceptance of that and the cost dynamics is a very essential part. And that is something which will get built up with the general consciousness as well as the paying ability of the consumer class as well. So we'll see how this develops going forward, but very interesting thoughts from both Shivanshu as well as Mohit on how the circular economy is developing and how is corporate India really trying to transition and incorporate it in their ESG journey. With that, it's a wrap on the show. Thanks so much for tuning in.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.